in the Hajj, in during Ihram. Rafath means sexual intercourse and whatever is encouraged to it. And Fusuq means there's no wicked actions. And Jidal means no quarreling or fighting by word or by action. So all these things, very important, these things are forbidden during Ihram. It is forbidden, other things like quarreling or wicked things in all the time, but especially in the Ihram, of course, the person should keep himself away from these things. The second one is a man who is in Ihram, he is not allowed to marry or give himself in marriage or propose someone for marriage. It is not allowed for him. But according to Imam Abu Hanifa, if someone married in the situation of Ihram, his marriage is valid. But others said, though, even the marriage is not valid because he was forbidden to do so. And the third one is covering head is not allowed for men. For men, it's not allowed to cover head, although he can benefit from the shade of umbrella or from the shade of a tree or for anything. It is allowed for him. Also, it is allowed for reason if someone wants to carry some heavy baggage on his head for the short time, but not covering, not as, not to, in purpose of covering head itself. And the third one is cutting nail or cutting hair. It is not allowed during Ihram. And also it is not allowed to wear any kind of perfume during Ihram, not in your clothes and not in your body, but it is allowed to, you can wash your hand with the soap, which has no smell. Even if it has, you don't have to pay penalty for that, but avoid as much as possible from these luxurious things. So, and the fifth one is hunting, or helping in hunting, or eating the game meat. Is it not allowed for a person who is in Ihram? And the last one is that in Haram itself, the boundary of the Haram, it is not allowed for Muhrim and for non-Muhrim, both, to cut a tree or to hunt or to kill any animal. It is not allowed for him. Or to disturb any animal also, like pigeons or other things, you don't have to disturb them. In all these restrictions, if anybody commits any of these restrictions by some severe reason, for example, he has some illness or some like in the head, he has to cut his hair or shave it for the treatment, it is allowed for him and there is no penalty for him. But intercourse which avoid the Hajj absolutely, there is no way to, this Hajj will not be accepted as a faridah, as a discharging the duty of Allah. The person who commits this, he has to continue completing this Hajj. He has to go through all ritual of the Hajj, but he has to re-perform again the Hajj next year or whenever it is suitable for him. Also, he has to slaughter a budna, which is camel, not sheep or goat, because his action was severe during the Ihram. But if someone is getting married backbiting or telling lie, all these things, is of course the person who get sin, but these things will not impose him to pay penalty for that. There is something permissible during Ihram, and these are like scratching the body, or if there is some hair is loose and is by combing, for example, without intention to take off the hair, if some hair came out, there is no penalty for that as well. Also, buying and selling it is allowed during Ihram. The person who can do trade while he is performing Hajj as well. And also, it is allowed for Muhrim who is in Ihram. The person who is in Ihram is called Muhrim. I will express this word. So, Muhrim is allowed to have shower as much as he wants, whenever he needed. And he is allowed to change his clothes whenever he wants. And for women as well, it's the same thing. For women, there is no special clothes for them. Their normal dress, which covering whole their body except face and hand, it is their ihram. But for men, it is two white robe, which one top of that is used as a like shawl, and the other one used like as pajama or some covering the lower part of the body. And it is also allowed for a muhrim who is in ihram to kill or to make away some harmful insect or harmful animal, or he's an, so there's no restriction to avoid these things. He can take away from his body without any kind of action which can be harm, mosquito or other things. We do not allow him to let him bite him, but because he is in ihram, he is allowed to remove that insect to harming him. Also, it is allowed for men and women to wear belt, which is stitched, of course, to keep his money or any documents or whatever he needs, papers and other things. Also, it is allowed for him to hang, to keep like a small bag. It is allowed for him during ihram. So this is the first rukun of Hajj, ihram, and all about ihram. Let's move to the second rukun, second important pillar of Hajj, which is Wukufi Arafah. Wukuf means standing in word, but it means being present or staying in that place. It's called Wukuf. Rasulullah says, and this is the biggest rukun of Islam, Al-Hajju Al-Arafah. Hajj is Arafah. The main duty in Hajj is being in Arafah, even for a moment. Even in the situation of sleeping or lying down or someone in unconscious, if someone been present there, his Hajj will be valid. It happened in Haram that a person who's been injured or accidentally or has become sick is unable to go for Hajj. But in the hospital, I've been there in the hospitals to make sure that on the day of 9th, which is Wukuf Arafah day, there is arrangement from the hospital. Even they take patient by the ambulance, just pass from this area while they are sleeping or they are not in conscious to make their Hajj valid, because they came from long way to perform Hajj, but they were unable for any reason to perform Hajj. But it is arranged by the hospital authorities. I had made sure about these things. So in Wukuf Arafah, there are some conditions, some wajibat, and these are the same wajibat of Hajj, which is staying in Mina for the night, also staying in Muzdalifah, doing Ramy first day, Zibh, Qurbani, and making shaving head or cutting short. Women are allowed to cut about half an inch from the end of their hair, and also Ramy. Stoning for the to the pillars, three pillars, other 2 days after Eid day, which is 11th and 12th of Zulhijjah. So all these, and the last one, which is Tawafi Wada, all these are the important and conditions of Tawafi Ziyarah. In Tawafi Ziyarah, in Wukuf Arafah, when you are there, it is recommended for pilgrims to arrive in Arafat about Zuhr time. Wukuf Arafah start from Zuhr time, from midday. But if they are there before that time, they can have rest there. And when the Zuhr time enter, if it is possible for them to have shower and ghusl, and they proceed if they can go to the mosque in Arafat, which is called Masjid al-Nimra, and perform their prayer combined and short with Imam. Zuhr and Asr in Zuhr time. All 4 rakats has been prayed there with Imam, 2 rakats each. If it is possible for them to go, otherwise they can do it in their camps with their groups. So, and it is good for them or recommended to listen to the khutbah of the Imam, which is given every year after in Wukuf Arafah. And this is the Eid day for Hajj, for Hajjis. Wukuf Arafah day, 1 day before the Eid day, normal Eid day. Also, there is while you are in Arafah, it is recommended for the pilgrims to do as much as possible tasbih, dhikr, tahleel, takbir, reciting Quran, remembrance of Allah, or doing any good thing. Helping each other is regarded very good deed. So pilgrims are advised to do as much possible all these good deeds, and they have to stand for praying and asking for seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until the sunset. They should not move from Arafat before sunset. They have to stay from midday to sunset. After sunset, they do not have to pray Maghrib prayer. They have to rush to Muzdalifah after sunset without praying Maghrib prayer. And when they arrive in Muzdalifah, which is Muzdalifah, which is between Mina and Arafat, halfway. So pilgrims were going to spend their night in Muzdalifah. So whenever they arrive in Muzdalifah, they have to pray Maghrib and Isha prayer combined. 3 rakat for Maghrib and 2 rakat for Isha Qasr, with one azan and 2 takbir, 2 iqama separately. So this Maghrib prayer is offered in Muzdalifah, not in Arafat, no matter how late you arrive in Muzdalifah. And in Muzdalifah, there is no much work to do. There's only staying in Muzdalifah. This is the wajib, according to most of the ulama and Imam Hanifa. If by any reason, the most reason is traffic congestion, if you are unable to stay in Muzdalifah, just you pass, you did not even get chance to get out from the car or from the coach to stop or spend night in Muzdalifah. But if you pass through Muzdalifah, there will be no penalty for that. But without any reason, if someone leaves spending night in Muzdalifah, then there is penalty to be paid, qurbani. In Muzdalifah, it will be spending night of the 10th of Zilhijjah. Next morning will be the 10th of Zilhijjah, which is the Eid day, and it's called Yawm al-Nahr, the day of Qurbani. And that day, pilgrims offer Fajr prayer, and if there is if it is possible with Imam in Mashr al-Haram, then they had to go to Mashr al-Haram. Otherwise, they are with their groups, and in the there's no camp there, but they have to pray offer where they are staying or spending the night close to their coaches. So when the daylight has come, then it is recommended for pilgrims to make dua before leaving to Mina, and after sunrising, they start moving to Mina again. So in Mina, it is allowed for women and children, also for sick people, even they can move from without spending whole night in Mina. In Muzdalifah, they can move from midnight to Mina. But without any reason, they have to stop there to be there for whole night. After arriving in Mina on the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah, there are 4 things to be done. The first one is, when you arrive, you put your baggage or things in the Mina, in your camp. Then first thing has been done is Rami, which is stoning. Stoning the shaitans. Only one shaitan, which is called Jamra al-Aqba, and with 7 pebbles. And these pebbles can be picked from Muzdalifah or from Mina itself. It's not important to be picked from Muzdalifah. So it can be picked from Muzdalifah or from Mina. And only one shaitan, which is Jamra al-Aqba, which is the closest to Makkah. There are 3 pillars. And the first one, which is closest to Makkah, is called Jamra al-Aqba, the big shaitan. And then after that, the middle one, and after that, which is closest to Mina itself, it's called the small shaitan, or Jamra al-Sughra. So after Rami, the second thing you have to do is sacrificing, doing qurbani. After qurbani, the third one is shaving your head or cutting it short, and the fourth one, which can be done it is recommended to be done in the same day, otherwise can be delayed during the Eid days, like 11th and 12th or 13th of the 13th of Zulhijjah, so which is Tawaf Ziyarah. So these 4 things, Rami, Qurbani, and Halaq or Taqsir. Halaq and Taqsir, when I say Halaq and Taqsir, you understand, Halaq means shaving head, and Taqsir means cutting it short. So these 3 things, and the 4th one is Tawaf Ziyarah, which is called Tawaf Ifada, and Tawaf Hajj, and Tawaf Wajib also. These 4 things are recommended to be done in the 10th of Zilhijjah, on the Eid day, if it is possible. In Tawaf Ziyarah, I'll explain about the Rami and other things later on. Let's go with Tawaf Ziyarah. The word Tawaf means encircling the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 7 times. This has also some conditions and some sunan and some adab of this Tawaf. Condition are in this dua, the person should be clean with ghusl and wudu. Wudu is needed for three things. It's basic things for reading Quran, touching it, and for tawaf and for prayer. These three things need fresh wudu, need wudu. Other things, there's no wudu is not recommended, but not necessary. So the person who is doing tawaf must be clean with ghusl and with wudu. And it is, tawaf is like prayer. Rasulullah said tawaf is like prayer, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed you to talk during tawaf. But talking unnecessary is not allowed, of course. The third one, the second condition is body must be covered. Like we cover our body while we're praying, or when we pray our obligatory prayers. And the third one is encircling is done anti-clockwise. I mean, the Kaaba itself, it should be on your left-hand side, and you go circling like this, starting and ending your tawaf from the black stone, which is Hajar Aswad. And the last sunnah, a condition for the tawaf is that the tawaf must be continuous, without stopping, without any reason. You can stop tawaf for some reason. For example, for praying obligatory prayer. For example, while you're doing tawaf, azan for asar or zuhar has been called and people started standing to pray. So you stop your tawaf at the same point and offer your prayer with the imam. And once imam finished prayer, you start from the same point you stop there and complete the same one round. So the tawaf must be done continuously without breaking. And you can break it for some reason only, for several reasons. For example, if you need fresh wudu during during tawaf, so you stop tawaf where your wudu is void or broken, then go make fresh wudu and return back and start from the same point. For example, if you have done three tawaf, you start again from the same point and complete another four to make it seven. All right. After tawaf, there is two rakat prayer behind Maqam Ibrahim. Maqam Ibrahim, which was explained by Brother Ashur Shams, which is about 10 meters, less than that, from the wall of Kaaba Sharif. So, but it, offering prayer two rakat, according to Imam Abu Hanifa, is it wajib, but according to other imams, it is sunnah only. And offering it behind Maqam Ibrahim is just recommended, it's not important and necessary. It can be offered anywhere in the mosque. Especially if there is congestion, there is too much crowd, it is advised to offer it a little bit away from this place inside the mosque. And also it is sunnah to, while you're doing tawaf, to kiss Hajar Aswad, if it is possible, without pushing anybody or harming anybody. If it is possible to kiss each round, if it's not possible, just to touch it from touch it, or just point to it and just kiss your hand. And starting, it is start by saying Allahu Akbar, Bismillah Allahu Akbar, Bismillah Allahu Akbar, Walillahi alhamd. And it is recommended to recite a dua, which is Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar, between Rukn Yamani and Hajar Aswad. This dua is recommended between these two corner of the house of Allah. But it is pilgrims can do as much zikr, tasbih, tahleel, or reciting Quran Sharif while they are doing tawaf, especially the third kalma, subhanallah, subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wala ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wala hawla wala quwwata illa billah al-aliyyil azim. And you can pray while you are doing tawaf for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for yourself, for your family, or for anybody. And it is recommended also, it is sunnah to make to drink zamzam first, then come back again, and while you're drinking zamzam, drink as much as you can. It is no harm for drinking too much zamzam water. It is recommended to drink as much as you can, and while you're drinking, make intention. It has been said in the Quran, in the hadith, zamzam for the intention is been made. If you drink to get health, Allah give you health. If you drink having intention, Allah give you knowledge, Allah give you knowledge. And there is a dua which is mentioned by Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala. He says that dua, Allahumma inni asaluka ilman nafi'an wa rizqan wasi'an wa amalan mutaqabbalan wa shafa'a min kulli da'in zahiran wa batinan. After drinking zamzam, come back. If it is possible, during Hajj, it is very difficult. to go to the multazam. And multazam, it is placed between the door of Kaaba and Hajar Aswad, the black stone, which is about 1 meter and a half, or maximum is 2 meter wide. So this place is called multazam. Multazam means place where you touch your body, your chest, and your face towards Kaaba, press against it, and make dua. And this place, you feel so much close to Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. So this is, and it's been said in the hadith that this is place where Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala accept all the dua. Also, it is recommended to dua and to make dua inside the hatim under the mizab. I don't know what it's called in the which is mizab parnala. Parnala jo hota hai hatim, the drain pipe, water draining. This is made of gold. Under that mizab, it is also it's recommended to make dua as much as possible and offering 2 rakat nafil inside the hatim. Hatim, which is like boundary outside the Kaaba, but it is included in the Kaaba. So tawaf is done including the hatim, outside the hatim. If someone does tawaf inside the hatim, his tawaf is not complete. So tawaf must be done from outside the, including the hatim itself. And these are the sunan about the tawaf. And there is some adab, some etiquette of tawaf. And what is, when you perform tawaf, you be humble while you're doing tawaf, very humble, and feeling that Allah is with you and you are close to Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, not harming, not looking here and there, just showing your willingness to Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, and feeling that the azma, the greatness of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala in your heart. And also, it is among the adab, this manner is not to talk during tawaf, except it is when it is very necessary, then you can talk, which is allowed. And also avoid to harm anybody through your word or through your action. Also, it is from adab not to raise your voice while you're doing tasbih or zikr. You hear there are some people, they read tasbih and zikr very, very loud voice, which disturb others. And sometimes it's help others as well to recite behind them. So it is good thing sometimes, but it's not easy to follow them in all the way. There are some things to note about tawaf. During tawaf, if an obligatory prayer, as I mentioned, the time of obligatory prayer comes, you stop your tawaf and pray, then restart again. And if you need wudu, then stop your tawaf, make fresh wudu, and come back and restart from the same point. And also, if you have doubt while you're doing tawaf, you have doubt in the numbers, that you have done 3 tawafs, 3 rounds, or 4 rounds. So, depend upon the round which you are sure about. Of course, if you have doubt in 3 and 4, it means you are not sure about the 4th one, but you are sure about the 3rd one. So count it as 3 and complete other 4 to make 7. Also, it is allowed for disabled person who cannot walk by himself to seek assistance from other to help him while doing tawaf, either to carry him even in his shoulder or on his back or on wheelchair or on the stretcher that is provided. People can do tawaf by sitting or lying on the stretcher. These are the adabs or things to note about the tawaf. And there are some things to be avoided during tawaf. One of these, tawaf inside the hatim, as I mentioned, because if you do tawaf inside hatim, your tawaf is circling, is not completed. So must be done from outside the hatim. And also, it's people, sometimes if you go there, you notice that people are hurrying, walking very fast during all the tawaf, which is, it is not allowed. It is not recommended. Hurrying or making ramal, which we'll mention it later on. There's 2 words for tawaf, ramal and istiba. Do you have mihram, kulota mihram? I can show them, if you can. There is 2 things, ramal and istiba, which is sunnah in the tawaf, but it is sunnah in the tawaf, which is followed by sa'i, not in old tawaf, and which is followed by sa'i in ihram, in the condition of ihram. Like it is not tawaf, there's no ramal and istiba in the tawaf, which is in tawaf ziyara. There is sa'i, but this sa'i and tawaf is being done without ihram. Because when you do tawaf ziyara, you do in your tawaf ziyara in your normal clothes without any restriction of ihram. So ramal means walking fast in three rounds, first three rounds only, and showing your braveness. And this is the historical thing that when Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came first time to perform Umrah, and Mushrikeen Makkah and believers they gathered together and said, look at these believers, humma Yathrib, means the fever or hot temperature in Yathrib in Medina, make them weak, they are very weak. So Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to them, show them your braveness, walk fast and showing your braveness. So this is the tradition behind that. So this is called ramal. Ramal means walking fast in three rounds only and showing your braveness. And the other thing which is sunnah in the tawaf is called istiba. I'll explain to you how to do istiba. And this one is also, it is sunnah in only three rounds, first three rounds. And how you put your ihram for istiba, I'll show you this one. The only top part of the ihram, istiba means leave your right shoulder open and cover only your left shoulder, putting ihram like this. So this is called istiba. So leave your shoulder open for first three rounds only, not all the round. But if someone is leave it open for all the time if you're feeling very hot, it is no matter. So it doesn't matter if you can doing tawaf without even the top one. The satar, which is for men, it is from here to the knee. This is the important thing, should be covered. So this is the istiba. And there are some other things to be avoid during the tawaf. You notice there people are touching all the corner of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is not recommended. Only two, it's reported by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he himself only touched and kissed only two corners, Hajar Aswad and Rukn Yamani. And there's two other Rukn. Rukn means the corner, which is called Rukn Shami, which facing towards Sham, Syria. So these all four rukn, among these four, only two are recommended to be touched and kissed, but not all the rukn. And people are also touching the wall of the Kaaba, which is not recommended, which is not allowed, for barakah, for example. So, I have mentioned the three things, ihram, and waqoof in Arafah and tawaf ziyara. So all these three things have been mentioned. And the last thing, which is sa'i, and which is rukn according to all three, according to all, majority of the ulama, scholar of Islam, except Imam Abu Hanifa. Imam Abu Hanifa said that sa'i is not rukn, but all others say it is rukn also. In sa'i, all sa'i means hurrying, walking fast, between Safa and Marwa. There's two small mountains, Safa and Marwa, and the distance between these two mountains after seven rounds is equal to 3 miles. So it is long way, 3 miles distance, which includes seven rounds. So there is some condition for Sa'i also. You have to make intention that you are doing Sa'i, and Sa'i only be offered after Tawaf. There is no Sa'i without Tawaf. You have to perform tawaf first, then go for sa'i. Also, it is a condition that sa'i also be done continuously without breaking. You can break it for reason, as I explained to you, for prayer, for obligatory prayer, or for janaza prayer, or for having new wudu. This can be stopped, and you can do all these things, then return back and start from the same point and complete seven rounds, starting from Safa and ending at Marwa. From Safa to Marwa, from Safa to Marwa is counted one. And from Marwa to Safa again is counted two. Also, the things like this, from Safa is counted once, going from Safa to Marwa, and from Marwa to Marwa to Safa is counted one tawaf. So, all these rounds, starting from Safa to this will be finished at Marwa when you finish the seventh round. So, Safa, he started at Safa by praying, and these are the sunnah, that when you start Safa, say, stop on the what is called hillock of Safa and say the dua, Bismillah, Allahu Akbar. And it is mentioned by in the hadith of Jabir radiallahu ta'ala, and he said that Rasulullah used to say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar three times, and he used to say La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, wa lahu alhamdu wa huwa ala kulli shayin qadir, La ilaha illallah anjaza wa'ada wa nasara abda wa hazama al-ahzaba wahda. Rasulullah used to say this dua three times in each sa'i, from Safa to Marwa or from Marwa to Safa. And it's recommended to do tasbih, tazkir, tahleel, and recitation of the Quran, whatever you remember, dua, you can do during doing your sa'i. And there is two mark, which is green mark, milayn akhdarayn is called in Arabic. In this, between these two distance, men only have to rush, walk fast, run, if it is possible, if there is no so much crowded on, there's not much congestion, then men are allowed to run, not women. Women, they have to walk normally. There's some notes about the sa'i also. While you're doing sa'i, there is no wadu is necessary for sa'i, but you have to have ghusl, of course. You are clean, I mean, tahir, from hadath akbar, which is the biggest, which is called, which require ghusl. But there's no need for wadu for sa'i. Also, it is allowed to recite Quran while you're doing sa'i. And also, sa'i may be a start for obligatory prayer and janazah, as explained to you. And it is allowed also to perform sa'i for disabled on wheelchair. You can push or you can hire someone to do it. And there's some common mistake in sa'i. There's two or three. Raising hand in Safa and pointing towards Kaaba. You see there that people, especially people come from Eastern Africa, they point to after Allahu Akbar, like they're pointing to the Kaaba. It is not. Rasulullah has raised his hand for dua. You make dua standing, not facing towards Kaaba, but not pointing towards Kaaba. Facing towards Kaaba, raise your hand and make dua. Say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, and say the ayah of Quran, Inna Safa wal Marwata min sha'irillah, فَمَنْ حَجَّ الْبَيْتَ وَيْتَمَرَ فَلَا جُنَاهَ عَلَيْهِنْ يَتَّوَّهْ بِهِمَا. So this dua has been to be said on Safa, and then start your procedure of doing sa'i. Also, it is not, is people, they rush all the way from Marwa to Safa, and from Marwa to Safa, all the way rushing is not recommended, and it's not allowed. So these are a few things to note while you're doing sa'i. By this, we complete all the ritual of the Hajj, and there's two things to mention about. I will briefly explain how to do practically the Hajj completely. So before this, I just explained about Hajj for menstruating women. A menstruating woman can perform all the ritual of the Hajj except Tawaf. Tawaf she cannot perform because there's condition for Tawaf that you must be clean, having ghusl and wudu both. And because tawaf has been done inside the mosque, and in the case you are not clean, you are not allowed to go inside the mosque. But she has to make intention to perform hajj from miqat. She can, even in that situation, she put on ihram, make intention that she's going to perform umrah whenever it is possible, whenever she's clean. So even if there's no time, for example, she didn't get the time to perform tawaf and sa'i, and she's still in the ihram, and the day of hajj started, so she has to proceed for hajj in the same ihram. So while she made intention to do umrah first, then hajj first, then hajj, this means she was going to do hajj tamattu. But in this case, because she was not able to perform tawaf and sa'i to complete her umrah, and she's staying in the same ihram, so this hajj will be changed from tamattu to qiran. She has to proceed for hajj in the same ihram, making intention for hajj without changing ihram. So after finishing all the ritual of the hajj, staying in Mina, going to Arafat, and coming back, staying at night in Muzdalifa, then staying two nights in Muzdalifa, and stoning the pebbles and doing qurbani, and all ritual she has to do except tawaf. Tawaf she cannot do it, she has to wait until she is clean, then she go to Baitullah Sharif and do tawaf. And almost say, if even she was unable to perform tawaf due to, because her menstruation is not over, so some ulama, some scholar has given fatwa in Saudi Arabia also, that in this case, if she is afraid that she's going to miss her aeroplane or she's going to miss her group or her relatives, they cannot wait for her, in this case, ulama has allowed her to have ghusl and put some protection pad or something, and then go and perform tawaf ziyara. In this situation, it is allowed for her to perform tawaf ziyara, and there's no tawaf wida for her, only one tawaf. It will be enough for tawaf wida also. But for men, the last thing they have to do, which is wajib, it is tawaf wida. It is wajib. So, but for women, as I mentioned, it's one tawaf will be enough. It will be equal for both tawaf wida and tawaf ziyara. But if men have missed without any reason tawaf wida, then penalty must be paid. A qurbani should be done for missing the tawaf wida. But for women, there is no qurbani in this situation. And there is another issue about the Hajj for children. Hajj is not obligatory for children, as we know. But if a child wants to perform Hajj, he can do so. And if he is able to perform Hajj by himself, he's old enough to understand things, he can do everything by himself. Or if he's not, then his parent or his guardian can perform all the ritual of Hajj on his behalf, like throwing the stone or taking him with him or carrying him while he's doing tawaf or sa'i. So, and then inshallah, parents or guardians, they will get all the reward of the Hajj. But this Hajj of children who are under age of 15 or for girls to under 12, this Hajj will not be as Hajj of Fard Hajj. And when they become eligible, they have to perform their fariza, their obligatory Hajj again. So by this we come to the conclusion of all the ritual of the Hajj according as a manasik. I mean, what is wajib, what is fard, what is halal, and what is haram. I just explained briefly the practical way in practice how to perform Hajj. I mentioned in the paper that when you make intention, first make wudu, and before leaving home, make wudu and say salam to your family and say the dua for them, astaghfirukum Allah alladhi la yadhi wa da ya'uhu. And after that, at the time of traveling, you have to, when you get in the car or get in the aeroplane, you read dua, subhanallah sakhara lana haza wa ma kunna lahu muqrinin wa inna ila rabbina lamunqalibun. And a person can put pilgrims, male or female, can put their ihram from home, starting from, for example, from here, from home or on the aeroplane or the airport. But it should be done before the miqat, as I explained to you. And the miqat for people who are going from Europe, and the plane goes to Jeddah. The miqat for them comes before arriving in Jeddah, about half an hour time. So be careful about that. You should put on your ihram and make intention before that time. And if you are traveling by Saudi Airlines, they announce, there's announcement is made in the aeroplane that we will be approaching miqat about after 20 minutes time. They give some time people to get ready and make intention. So the tawaf, intention of ihram must be made from before reaching the miqat, that point. And if you see the mistake has been done in this regard, many people arrive in Jeddah without ihram, and they are going to Mecca. It is the big mistake. The penalty must be paid. And there is some reason. For example, if they're going to stay in Jeddah, not going straight to Mecca, if they're going to stay in Jeddah a few days, after that they're going to make intention and go for Umrah or for Hajj, then in this case they are allowed to go without ihram, because they are not going straight to perform tawaf. They have no intention for performing Umrah or Hajj. So in this case they can go without ihram. But if you have intention to go for Umrah straight to Mecca, then in this case you must have ihram before arriving to Mecca, before that point of miqat. And also it is mustahab, as I mentioned all these things about before at the miqat. If it is possible, if you are traveling for them by car or coming from Medina, at Miqat in Abyar Ali and Zul Halifa, you can make ghusl or wadu. There is facilities for that, and pray to rakat prayer in the mosque and make intention and say talbiya and proceed for Hajj. At the time of tawaf, when you arrive to Mecca, put your baggage. If you need to rest, rest. Rest is very important during all these rituals. You take your rest as much as possible. Do not make yourself tired, because and keep always in your mind there's lots of things you're going to do. So do not rush in the beginning for some very smaller things, and to lose later on the greater things. So rest is very important in all the way. So if you need, because if you are arriving there in Mecca after a very long journey, and there is very long delay in airport, and there is a very long traveling from, even it's very short distance from Mecca and Jeddah, but there is lots of procedure through. You have to pass through about the passport office and istiqbal and other things. So you get very tired. So if there is need to rest, go and rest, sleep, and then when you are ready for that, then go for tawaf. And entering, it is mustahab, recommended to go through Bab al-Umrah, or Bab al-Salam. And when you see first time to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, read dua, Allahumma zid baytaka hadha tashrifan wa ta'zeeman wa takreema. Wazid man sharrafahu wa karramahu, mimman hajjahu wa atamarahu tashrifan wa ta'zeeman wa takreema. And if you are going first time, you need to be, somebody has to lead you, because it's a very big mosque, and there's many, so many doors. You will be lost inside, and before going inside, you have to make sure from which door you came and from which door you're going to, because you're going, you see, everything is round there inside, and after doing 7 tawaf, you are in circle all the time. You don't know from which gate you came and which gate you have to go out. So make sure you make some kind of sign, and there's a sign I can tell you, with old building of Ottoman Empire time, where the mezana is, where from where the azan is called, there's two sides, and this mihrab, it is divided between. There's a roof between them, and there's very low ceiling. And this mihrab, one side is 2, another side is 4. Mihrab is covered with the glasses. It is very good sign for going and coming out. If you are missed, you just make sure, because if you are going to do tawaf, if you enter from that gate, from where the 4 doors are covered, 4 mihrab are covered with the glasses, it is very straight to the Hajar Aswad, to black stone. You normally go from that side if you are entering from Bab Abdul Aziz, King Abdul Aziz gate. So make sign from where you can meet your brother. Even you are 2 people, you do not be sure that you're not going to be lost each other. So you make sure that if I miss you or you miss me, we're going to meet at a certain point, as far as at the under that mezana where azan is given, or there is a green light for a starting point of the tawaf. This is, but you can notice it, this green light at night only. The daytime is very difficult to notice. But anyhow, you can make any kind of sign to meet there. While you're doing tawaf, as I explained, go through all the adab and its wajibat, doing tawaf in the way I explained to you. And this, by doing tawaf and sa'i after that, 7 rounds, you have to shave your hair or cut it short, and after that you become halal. For the person who is doing Hajj Tamattu, his one part of the Hajj, which is Umrah, is completed. After shaving his hair and cutting, there's a very big mistake is made for shaving or cutting hair, that when 2 or 3 people doing tawaf same way or together, and after finishing sa'i, they start cutting each other hair. In this case, people who had cut, he has to pay penalty. Because he was in tawaf, he had cut others' hair. Because while you are in haram, you are not allowed to cut hair or take off, shave your hair or cut your hair or cut your nail or anything. You ask this thing to be done by someone who is not in haram. It's very important thing to be noted that you should not cut anybody's hair while you are in ihram. And people think that when they finish 7 rounds of sa'i, the ihram is over. Ihram is not over yet until your hair is cut or is being shaved. So ask someone, there is, and about the, according to Imam Hanifa rahmatullah alayh, that the 1/4 of the hair must be cut to reach, to what is called, to read the point of taqsir. If there's two, three, four here is taken out, it doesn't mean anything. But according to Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah, even three here has been taken, it's been you are halal in this case. But Imam Abu Hanifa said that considerable amount of hair must be cut. And for women, they can cut each other here. They are allowed to cut each other here about half an inch from the end of the hair. And it's not rushing for that. You can do it when you are when you come back to your accommodation, or it's better to do it by proper barber. And there's lots of shops around there. Instead of putting your head under someone's mercy and he does very strange way, you'll be surprised by that. So by performing tawaf and sa'i, one part of the hajj, which is umrah, is completed. And the person who is doing tamattu, hajj tamattu, he has to stay and wait until the day of hajj. And day of hajj start from 8 Zilhijjah. And day of hajj are 5 or 6 days. Starting with the first day, which is 8 Zilhijjah, people go to Mina. And they started going from the morning, but it is recommended to be there before Zuhar. On the 8th of Zilhijjah, be in Mina before Zuhar. You pray Zuhar, Asr, Maghrib, and Isha, four prayer at that day, and next day Fajr. So these five prayer is recommended to be offered in Mina while you're staying at the night and next day. So the first day of work is spend night in Mina and offer these five prayers and do whatever good deeds you can do, reading Quran or reading Tasbih or helping each other in virtue and righteousness. So this is the first day is completed. Second day, the 9th of Zilhijjah, which is the biggest day and the most important day, which is Wukufi Arafah. You have to go to Arafat. And the distance from Mina to Arafat about minimum is 9 miles. And you go through Arafat and the via Arafat, via Muzdalifah. On arriving on Arafat, if you arrived very early in the morning, for example, or before afternoon, you have to wait until midday. And after Zawal, you have to pray Zuhar and Asr prayer. I think if it's convenient for you to go with pray with Imam, you do so. Otherwise, pray with in your camp with Taqsir and combining both prayers, Zuhar and Asr. And stay there and start reading and reciting. People understand that waquf arfa means waquf means literally standing. Waquf doesn't mean standing all the time. Waquf means being present there, staying there for zikr and tasbih on the 9th of Zilhijjah. So on the 9th of Zilhijjah, which is the second day of Hajj, is waquf arfa, most important thing. You stay there until sunset. After sunset, without offering your Maghrib prayer, move to Muzdalifah at that night. And when you arrive in Muzdalifah, no matter for how long you're going to be in Muzdalifah, if you stay in Muzdalifah for a little time, you have done your wajib. There's no penalty to be paid. And if you were, by any reason, we are unable to stay in Muzdalifah, did not arrive even next day, so there is no penalty upon you. So you have finished one day in Mina, second day in Arafat, and the night of Eid, you have spent in Muzdalifah. And next day after Fajr prayer, you move to Mina again, which is from Muzdalifah to Mina, roughly 3 miles, 3 or 4 miles. In Mina, coming at Mina on the 10th of Zilhijjah, which is the Eid day, there are 4 things to be done. First, you go to your camp, put your bag or other things, sleeping bag, and the first thing you have to do is Rami. The second one is Qurbani. The third one is shaving your head or making short. And the fourth one is Tawafi Ziyara. But there's no need to rush for all these things. Especially in these days, too much crowd there. You cannot do Rami. And it's not advisable for people, even very strong people. They do not rush for Rami in the very early time. It is advisable if they want to do even in recommended time, which is from the Fajr to sunset. It is recommended time for Rami on first day. It is advised for them to go at the later time, after Asr period. It is best time between Asr and Maghrib, and there is all crowded is over that by that time. And for women and for children or for old people, it is recommended for them to go at night, at that night, and do Rami. And people who are, for example, you are going with your wife or with the children, you cannot go once for yourself and then come back and go again for with your wife at night. You can go with them at night if you want to make it easy for them. So after doing Rami and that day, on the 10th of Zilhijjah, after doing Rami, and there is a question about Qurbani. Because in all these four things on 10th of Zilhijjah should be done in order. According to Imam Abu Hanifa rahmahullah, he says that all four things should be done in order. But there is fatwa, people have given fatwa in ulama in Saudi Arabia and also in our countries, in Pakistan, in India, since this new project is started to do Qurbani by buying coupon through bank. Because it makes things easier and there's lots of benefit by using this numerous amount of the meat. So doing Qurbani through coupon, you are not sure when your Qurbani will be done. So people are in dilemma when shall I shave our head or not? Because I'm not sure that Qurbani has been done or not. But ulama has said you can do Qurbani. There's no order is not important in that day. You can do all these four things even in this order. You can do Qurbani, Rami and Tawaf Ziyara and Halaq or Taqsir in any way it is useful for you. But if someone wants to make sure he's free, he can do on his way which he is satisfied according to his maslak who is following. So after Qurbani, the third things in order which left, which is Taqsir and Halaq, and the fourth thing which is Tawaf Ziyara. The time of Tawaf Ziyara is start from the Fajr, and some ulama says from the midnight of the 10th of Zilhijjah, and remain until the last day of Tashriq, last day of Qurbani, which is 13th of Zilhijjah. According to Imam Abu Hanifa, it is up to 13th of Zilhijjah. According to Imam Malik, it is up to the end of the month of Zilhijjah. And according to Imam Malik and Imam Shafi and Imam Ahmad, there is no end for the time of Tawaf Ziyara, whole year. You can do Tawaf Ziyara in the whole year whenever is suitable for you. But Imam Abu Hanifa said, if you delay Tawaf Ziyara, Tawaf Ifada, after that day, after 3 days of Eid, then a penalty must be paid, a Qurbani must be done for that. And Imam Malik says, if you delay after the month of Zilhijjah, then you have to pay a penalty, otherwise no. So this is the third day of the Hajj. In third day, all these four things have been done. That day is a very busy day, 10th of Zilhijjah. Qurami, Qurbani, Halaq, and Tawaf Ziyara. And it is not possible to do in these days all these four things except you have very strong commitment and you are strong enough to do all these things. And you are alone, for example, you are not with family. Okay. And while you are throwing stones, you need first day, on the eighth day, only 7 pebbles to throw on the big shaitan, on Jamra al-Aqba, which is closest to Makkah. After throwing, during all these rituals, you have to continue saying talbiyah, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. And first, when you throw first pebble on the stone, your talbiyah is stopped. At that time, your talbiyah is stopped. After throwing all this stone, you have to come back and without praying, or there is prayer after throwing the pebble, but only after throwing on the middle and small shaitan, not on the big shaitan. And while you throw the pebble, you make sure that this pebble reach to the pillar or touch the pillar at least, or to be in the, there is a surrounding made, surrounding things is surrounded the pillar. It should be thrown inside that bowl. Then your rami is expected. If you are not sure that if for example some one or two pebble is dropped in your hand, so you have to recover to make it, to throw other pebble in state, to make sure that you have thrown all seven pebbles. And next day, which is 11th of Zilhijjah, which is the fourth day of Hajj, there is no most work, only just throwing the pebbles on the three shaitans, and you will require on that day 21 pebbles. And pebbles must not be very big or not very small. Not very small, that is, you cannot feel and you cannot have any force to throw, and not very big, which can hurt somebody. So it's still about big pea, like big pea or big chana, we say in Urdu. So On the 11th of Dhul Hijjah, you start throwing pebble, starting with the small shaitan. Starting with the small shaitan, then middle, then the big one. After stoning, and while you stone, make Makkah on your left side and shaitan on your right hand side. While you throw from your right. This is the way of throwing. And after throwing seven pebble on middle, small and middle shaitan, you little bit go further towards Makkah, facing Makkah and pray. This is recommended. And it's been said that dua is expected in that place. But not, you do not make any dua after throwing pebbles on the big shaitan. This is the 11th of Dhul Hijjah. You had to spend the night in Makkah, in Mina. No matter you, if you are delayed, for example, for doing tawaf ziyarah in Makkah or shopping or something, but you have to come back even for, you do not stay in Makkah in intention to spend the night there. You have to come back in anyhow to Mina to spend the night in Mina, even for 1 hour or 2 hours or whatever the time it. You do not spend that night anywhere else. And when you finish on the 11th of Dhul Hijjah, you spend the night, and the next day, which is the 12th of Dhul Hijjah, after Zawal, the time of stoning the shaitans start from Zawal, from midday to the night. So the 12th of Dhul Hijjah, you stone again, all three pebbles, seven each, starting from a small to middle to the big one, and going the same procedure, making dua after stoning the small one and big one. By this, if anyone wish to move, go to Makkah or go to Medina, go to home, he's allowed to go. But Maman Ta'ajjala, this is allowed for him. And if someone wants to stay that night, but if you want to go, he has to go before sunset. And if you want to stay there, he has to stay at night. And next day, he cannot go before throwing the pebble. He has to throw the pebble again, repeating all this and all these three shaitans in the same way. And after that, he is allowed to go. But if someone wants to go after just 2 days throwing the shaitan, he can go. But before moving to your home or to Jeddah, for example, or to Medina, the last thing must be done, which is Tawafi Wida. As I explained, Tawafi Wida, it is wajib, and it must be performed by men. And if there is a reason, I explained for women, they, it is enough for them, only one Tawaf, and after that, it is the old ritual of the Hajj, and Tawaf, and Umrah, and all these things is completed. Jazakallahu khair. Sallallahu ta'ala khair.
Jazakallahu khair, brother. It's a lot to digest, and I'm sure lots and lots of points will come out of the talk that the brother's given. He was obviously going very quickly, and it's not his fault because he stuck to the time that we gave him. We do take notice of comments that are made in the questionnaire, as I say, apart from the one that said don't do it again. And one of the comments last year was the course was a little bit too long for one day. So this is why it's a little more condensed today. But we've left ourselves plenty of time for questions afterwards. And so we're really modifying the program. Well, I'm modifying the program as we are going along. What we plan to do was to have a question and answer session directly after the talk. But we've used all the time in the talk. So we'll reserve the question and answers, which I know you'll want to ask. And we'll combine it with the question and answer session between 5 and 6. Now, if we have to, we're prepared to continue after Salatul Asr with the question and answers. About 20 different people have come up to me and said, you must mention this and you must mention this. And inshallah, we'd like to bring out all these points because a lot of people have useful contributions to make and that would be of practical help for everybody here. So, as long as you're prepared to stay, we'll stay. And we'll close up with the buffet. So inshallah, now we will have a tea break. And just to show you how sexist we are, the men will enjoy their tea and cake. Just before the tea, I'll carry on with what I'm saying, but Imam Nadri would just like to clarify the points of the ziyarah to Medina, which is very, very important. So we'll do that right now, just before the tea. But as I say, the men will have their tea here. The ladies have a separate talk, which by nature of the talk we felt that the sisters would like to be on their own. Now, where you prayed Dhuhr, that is where you will have your talk. And the talk is again by Sister Shakila. And it's regarding the points particularly to do with the tawaf that will be of importance to the ladies. And also, the sister has some interesting things to say because she's been on Hajj twice within the last 2 years and Umrah twice. And it'll be a good chance just to have an informal talk as well. What you may wish to do is to maybe have your tea quickly and then, you know, go upstairs for the talk. We'd like you to be back here, please, for 4:30. So we'll spend 5 minutes now on the Ziyarah to Medina and then we'll break for tea. Jazakallah khair.
Just very brief, I'd like to explain. I'd like to thank Dr. Shakila Qureshi. She's raised a very good point, a very useful point to note about all the procedure of the Hajj and travel arrangement. And last year it was very useful article published in Urdu, in Jung, by me. And it is explained all the preparation of the Hajj.